Hello everybody, welcome to the zebris webinar, finding and saving a new bite. My name is Fabian Völker. I'm a dental technician. I was in the middle of Germany, and Mr. Bernhard Egger, I will say something to you.
Hello everyone, good morning, whatever time it is over there where you are. My name is Bernhard Egger. I'm assisting today Mr. Völker, and I'm looking forward to the next hour and try to support and answer your questions if there are any.
Yeah, thanks. So we will show you some skills how we can use the finding a new bite for a patient abrasionsgebiss?
In a worn dentition.
Yeah. For patients who have
worn dentition.
Worn dentition, yeah. So we will go on the presentation. Now we will show you some things you can buy at the zebris system. What is a zebris system? What you can use of these things and what are inside of the system. So please go on the PowerPoint, please. Here you see some of my dental laboratory in Marburg in the near Frankfurt.
What we forgot to mention is, if you have any questions, please use our question and answer column, and we will try to address if it is something that fits in the presentation right away. At the end of the presentation, there's of course always still the opportunity to start a discussion and. We read your questions on the screen in front of us and try to answer them in the chronological order. Thank you.
So, yes, here you see, this is my name, Fabian Völker. I'm a dental technician in Frankfurt, or the near Frankfurt. Here we will show you some things of the zebris JMA optic. Here you see the system is a light optic system. It's very simple to use it on the head. You have no cables, and this system is in the real digital workflow integrated. So here the stuff of the system, the upper jaw bow and the lower jaw bow, the C bow for registration, the head under the system. The system is a light optic system. You see it on the right side. Two cameras work with the system with the lower jaw and see all the movements of the patient. The history of the instrumental systemation is very old. You see Mr. Alfred Giese is one of the pioneers of the instrumental systems, and now we are in the digital world, so you can use the real movement for making some things, crowns or bite splints or something else. When you will do a measurement with the system, you need some stuff. The first, you need a para occlusion
tray or tray attachment.
Or attachment. This attachment is sitting on the lower jaw, and the occlusion is nicht gestört.
Genau. Yeah, when you apply this in preparation for your measurement, you need to make sure that it doesn't. Inhibit the full closure, and that it doesn't represent any kind of interference, because you're obviously recording jaw motions. So you want to make sure that there is resin touching the occlusal surface of the mandible.
Yeah. Vielleicht spreche ich ein bisschen auf Deutsch und Sie übersetzen ein bisschen mehr, es war ein bisschen einfacher. Das Ganze gibt es natürlich auch in der digitalen Welt, in dem Fall in der Exocad konzipiert mit dem Schienenmodul.
You can, instead of using this prefabricated attachment, you can design your attachment in a design software. In this case, it would be the ExoCAD software, but there are other dental designing softwares available that you could use to design this attachment and then print it and use it for your measurement.
Also, you can do it in chair side in the mouth of the patient. You see it with an provisorum material.
Yeah, this is
acrylic.
This is a temporary resin that you would use to fabricate chair side temps, and like pro temp, for example. And you apply this on the facial and buccal surfaces. You loaded the prefabricated attachment, and now you put it in place. The patient has closed into CO, complete occlusion. And so while the resin is setting and curing, you hold the attachment in place.
Yeah. The second that you need for the using the real movement in the construction software, you need then the bite fork.
The bite fork, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Vielleicht angepasst an den Oberkiefer mit einem Registratsmaterial.
So the bite fork, as you can see on the right image, does have three referent points. So it's underneath the blue impression material, or left, right, and in the center of the bite fork. And that is a reference that will be later the guide to match and merge the scans of the maxillary the maxillary scan and the mandibular scan with this bite fork.
Yeah. And the third is the upper jaw chick. With this chick you can sperren die occlusion. Oh God.
Yeah, we use this anterior jig to increase the vertical dimension. And in our example here, try to design and prepare, the recording to fabricate a bite appliance. And ideally, you want to create that jig at the same vertical as the desired bite appliance is supposed to be designed and finally working in the mouth. So anterior jig at the same vertical, ideally, as the bite appliance.
Good. Here you see the software models of the system you can buy. The first, the articulator, is the basic module. All other modules you can buy later, or which you want, you can use it. Here we will have a little review of the last webinar. There we have show you how to use the articulator movements for using for some prosthetic systems or ground splints or something else. Here Mr. Dr. Wegmann show you how work with the zebra system. I don't know how many people of you working with the system, or you will buy it. So here you see how the system is work.
It's actually, if you're used to osteopath recording, a very similar setup, except of course the bite fork that is being used to transfer the maxillary position into the software. But if you work with this system, you realize that how much faster it is, how much more streamlined the whole workflow and process is. So in a couple of minutes, actually, you finished all the preparation. And if you compare that to traditional recording, then you realize you save probably more than 50% of your time. So you set up the system, and you ask the patient to perform protrusive, retrusive movements, lateral movements, opening, and so then you save this record.
When you have saved the record, you can use the movement for anything which you would like to do in your ExoCut software, so you have the real movement of the patient.
So this recording is being exported, and it is now available in this in the ExoCut designing software. You have to load the or import the patient-specific files, such as scans, and of course also the jaw motion recording file, and then you can start your design. So this is the bite fork again. It is also stored as a reference within the software, and it allows you to mount virtually the maxillary scan as it is in 3D space located at the patient's head. It's a very straightforward procedure. Doesn't take a rocket scientist. The whole workflow is very streamlined and within a few minutes, as you can watch this procedure right now, end up with mounted models in a virtual articulator.
Genau, vielleicht können Sie auch noch sagen, dass man zwei Wege wählen kann. Entweder kann man die echte Bewegung nutzen oder halt die optimierte dynamische Bewegung, je nachdem, ob man die Bewegung verwenden möchte. Yeah.
So it is entirely up to you if you still favorite a mechanical or virtual copy of a mechanical articulator. You would then import the settings that the software for the articulator automatically generates. So if I'm referring to software, I mean the zebris software. Or your preference is to skip the articulator and just use the real movement data. In that case, you actually don't need the articulator because, well, it's obsolete.
Genau, speziell in dem späteren Patientenfall wird man sehen, dass wir natürlich auch immer, wenn wir ein stark Abrasionsgebiss haben, dass wir dann natürlich eher eine artikulatordynamische Bewegung nutzen und nicht die vermeintlich krankhafte Patientenbewegung.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So keep in mind that if you're planning to work on a case where you have to increase the vertical dimension and you want to restore this patient later on and this patient has even a significant amount of wear, then the recording that you made on this specific patient might show interferences, like you see here in this case, and those interferences do not represent the ideal movements that a patient would have in an unwarranted incision. So therefore, it might still make sense to use setup of the virtual articulator to prove and verify later on, once your design is ready, that this is fully functional and operational.
Now, wenn wir natürlich im komplett digitalen Workflow arbeiten wollen, und das ist ja das, was wir heute zeigen wollen, arbeiten wir natürlich heute mit Intraoral-Scan-Systemen. Hier einfach mal zwei beispielhaft genannt, aber es sind natürlich alle Systeme nutzbar.
The software doesn't have any kind of limitation in terms of intraoral scans, so whatever your preference is, any major brand, actually any kind of brand, as long as it is capable to export the file, the intraoral scan in the so-called STL format it can be used and imported into the zebris software. The same goes for the exocad software.
Ja. Wichtig ist halt, dass man diesen Marker-Scan macht, wie man es in der Präsentation sieht, weil das natürlich die Nullposition ermittelt oder im dreidimensionalen Raum.
So keep in mind that this byte fork is crucial to capture the correct relationship. It's a so-called marker scan, but you would be guided in your workflow through this procedure, and I guess in a couple of seconds you show the workflow. Is that correct? Yeah. So you're going to see it anyways.
Yeah. So now we will show you the live demo of the Kiefer Relationsbestimmung. The jaw relation.
Jaw relationship.
Yeah. We give the upper jaw system on the head. You see here you have thumb. Was heißt denn Feder?
Yeah, there's this little silicon attachment band that automatically adapts the bow to your to the shape of your head.
Mm-hmm. So yeah. So now we're in the zebris software. You see on the left side the patients, how many patients you have recorded with the system, and on the right side you see the recording. Here the numbers, how many recording you have made for this patient, at which data, and which software model you have used. So when the patient is inside, we go on measure. You see here the some software models you can buy of the zebris system. Now at this time we will go to the jaw relation. We starting the software. So in the first step, the system will receive the left porion. We go with the SIBO in the left porion inside. We will see that. Oh, so no, the light is very high, so go with it like this. So we see the left porion.
Can I just explain where this noise occurred?
Okay.
This is an optical system, right? So you want to make sure that there's no direct sunlight or like you just saw a reflection actually. That's why this sound occurred. You see this little green attachment at the bottom, which indicates that you're good to go to perform the measurement. And now it turned red again, which simply indicates that there's no connection. But now you're back,
so orbital
and it
point.
Will stop.
Push. So now the head is inside.
Captured.
Captured, yes. Yep. Next time you need the power occlusion attachment, so like this, my occlusion.
So this has been prepared, obviously.
And the
jig. And this is the anterior jig we talked about at the vertical. We would like to fabricate the bite appliance.
First
so it's an open bite record, if you will.
First step on the plateau, then the real position. Ich sage den Patienten immer leicht vorschieben und dann so weit sie können zurück.
Yeah. So, what you want to prepare your patient for this procedure? I guess you would probably do the same if you would do an analog recording. So, same goes for this position. However, for this recording, however, what is very convenient from my point of view is that if for whatever reason it doesn't work, you can always skip back and say, let's do it again. So there's no pressure, no time frame that you need to shoot for. It's simply if you see that the patient doesn't perform this movement correctly, you just restart.
Before we recording the target points, the patient must do 10 times
opening and closing. Yeah. Right. So 10 times opening and closing, that's being recorded.
So, and then open. Kurz davor, also
yeah, so don't touch the anterior jig after you opened and close, or had the patient open and close. So you stop probably 1 or 2 millimeters before you would touch the anterior jig. And you see that most points are within this green dot or center. And what the software does is it actually takes all points into account and then creates an ideal point out of those measurements.
And then the guiding registration, the same like
opening and closing.
So I will move the lower jaw into the center, and then registration material inside of the teeth.
Yeah. Yeah. So once the patient has found that position, it is being indicated by this sound, which tells you, in accordance to the image that you see there, that this is the hinge axis, and now you could use your bite registration silicone material to basically verify or lock it up, and you could use that then later to mount your models.
Jetzt sehen Sie, wie schnell das geht.
So that was it.
Saving in close. So now we have a new lower jaw position. Neuromuscular
position.
Then we go back, like here. And now I will show you the patient fall. Here you see Mrs. Dr. Lara Hansen. She's the dental of the patient.
The dentist?
The dentist, yeah.
Yeah.
The dentist, yes.
So that's a case report that we're looking at. The dentist is Dr. Lara Hansen from Marburg near Frankfurt. And she's the quote is of her, from her is her goal is to restore a patient's masticatory system only once and keep it healthy for a lifetime.
Okay, vielleicht können Sie noch was zur Historie des Patienten sagen?
Yeah, a little bit history on the patient. So this patient hasn't seen a dentist for 20 years. I guess that's a little bit visible. And he has a lot of wear. And it was clear that the bite needed to be increased. But the question was, how are you going to do this?
Yeah. Here you see the situation of the patient instead of his mouth over here, like this.
Yeah, 20 years, fly by.
Der Patient ist eigentlich erst zu uns gekommen, als die Front gefallen ist, als es also für den Rest auffällig war, gell?
Ja. Yeah.
Genau. Als ersten Schritt haben wir das Ganze mit einem Intraoral-Scan digitalisiert.
Mm-hmm. So the very first step was to take intraoral scans. In this case presentation, it was a Medit i500.
Genau. Ja. Und dann haben wir das Ganze in gedruckte Modelle umgesetzt und mit der Kieferrelationsbestimmung in die ExoCAD-Software die Scans übertragen.
Yeah, those intraoral scans were the basis for printed models, those printed models, you're going to see them later, have then been used to fabricate the temporary restoration.
Yeah, genau.
The designing was again done with the Exocad software.
So, show you here. Oh. What is this? So, that's live.
This is an overlay of a before and after situation, before and the virtual wax up.
So we come from here, there's a digital wax up like this.
I find it fascinating that we still call it wax up. Obviously, there is no wax involved at all, yeah. But you know. Yes, up until today, no one came up with a better, with a better term.
So we see here, wir haben natürlich die Sperrung dementsprechend auch gewählt, dass wir auch gleich für die restaurative Versorgung die Chance haben, genügend Platz zwischen den Zahnreihen zu haben.
Yeah. As you might remember, the initial jaw motion recording was performed at the desired vertical of the bite appliance, and the, that was coincidental with. The vertical dimension that was sort of envisioned to fabricate or design the final restoration. And so if this is all congruent, it's a very smooth flow.
Genau, vielleicht können wir gleich auf die erste Frage eingehen, ob man digital geprintete Modelle braucht. Nein.
Okay. No. This is probably, thanks for your question. This is probably a little bit misleading. The printed models were not necessary to start the designing process. The printed models were actually just necessary to double check and verify that the milled and printed restoration that you're going to see in a few minutes were accurate and correctly positioned. Just to add to that, I mean, it is I would never recommend to solely rely on a digital workflow without the proof of a model. This is not a sign that you haven't mastered your designing and manufacturing process. It's simply a proof that the digital workflow does work, and there is no surprise. When the restoration is inserted in the mouth.
Wir haben sogar die Erfahrung gemacht, dass der reine digitale Prozess deutlich genauer ist als sogar der Zwischenstep mit einem Modell natürlich.
Ja.
Genau. The first is the preparation of the first quadrant.
Yeah, the preparation of the first quadrant. Let me just explain what you told me about the case, right?
Genau.
So the case preparation was started on a Friday.
Yeah.
And so it wasn't possible to prep all teeth and do the manufacturing on one day. So it was split up. The first quadrant was restored. Prepared and then temporarily restored on Friday, and then on the next Monday, the second quadrant followed.
Ja. Ja. Wir haben uns hier vielleicht auch noch vorweg zu sagen, dass wir den Zwischenstep mit der klassischen Schiene übersprungen haben, weil die Zähne so starke Probleme hatten, dass wir zeitig mit der Präparation beginnen wollten.
Wenn ich das jetzt, nachdem wir über den Chip geredet haben, lass es weg.
Lass es weg, okay, gut, alles klar.
Ja,
okay, genau. Hier, vielleicht können Sie das erzählen zu dem Thema. Wir haben uns natürlich ein gedrucktes Modell oben links gemacht, um einen Einsatzschlüssel für das Eierschalenprovisorium zu generieren und dann im zweiten Step das Snap-on, um den Patienten nach Hause entlassen zu können mit einer ausbalancierten Okklusion.
Okay, so the Exocad software has an interesting feature, and that is to design a so-called eggshell temporary restoration. What it means is, well, I mean, you all know what an eggshell is. I guess I don't have to explain it that far. So it allows the patient, the dentist, even before preparation, to have already the desired design of the restoration at hand. Now, you don't know how much reduction is necessary. That's why you fabricate an eggshell restoration. However, this restoration doesn't rest upon the prepped remaining tooth structure, so therefore you need an insertion guide. So on the far left side, you see the printed model. You see the actual temporary restoration. You see at the bottom the insertion guide. In the center, again, the insertion guide capturing or holding the actual temporary restoration. And that's your reference to place it in the mouth, and it works very well.
Yeah. Hier die Snap-on-Schiene für den anderen Quadranten und natürlich den Patienten optimal.
So on the right side, keep in mind that the procedure was started on a Friday. The right side wasn't prepped, but the patient obviously needed something to chew on over the weekend. And on the right, the second quadrant was therefore restored with a so-called snap-on. It was a second temporary solution, as it was removed on Monday after the patient returned to the office.
Yeah. Hier das Eierschalenposition positioniert.
Yeah. So on the left side, the eggshell restoration positioned.
Mit der snap-on.
And the right quadrant again. Picture is taken on Friday. On the right side, a snap-on.
Am Montag dann die Präparation des zweiten Quadranten.
Yeah, so this is Monday. New day, new start. And the second quadrant is had been prepped. These are a couple of images of the preparation.
Eine Frage dazu darum.
With what module was the snap-on designed? I don't know.
Mit Model Creator of, from the ExoCAD.
Model Creator ExoCAD software.
Ja. Genau. Positionierung der Eierschalenposition im zweiten Quadranten.
Ja. Same procedure as you saw in the images before. Eggshell temporary restoration inserted with an insertion guide. 100% in the same position as it had been virtually designed, relined in the mouth, and these are the actual, the relined on the inside intaglio, relined actual temps intraoral.
Genau. Nach drei Wochen haben wir das Ganze dann noch auf ein gefrästes Provisorium auf die Brettgrenze erstellt.
So then, 3 weeks later, the decision was made that lab fabricated temporary restoration would serve the patient best, and so these are already this is the temporary restoration.
Yes.
Fabricated and designed in the laboratory.
Yeah.
And so, if I'm not mistaken, the patient wore it for 3 months.
Yeah,
for a test and trial.
Three and a half.
Yeah, three and a half. Okay.
Yeah. So like this, I think it's very nice. And the final prep, nach 3 Monaten oder 3,5 Monaten, in diesem Fall hat sich der Patient auch noch dazu entschieden, die Unterkieferfrontzähne mit Veneers zu versehen, weil er die Approximalkontakte noch geschlossen haben wollte, um es als einheitliches Bild sehen zu können. Mm-hmm.
So those 3 months finally convinced the patient that he should consider restoring the lower anterior teeth as well. There is obviously quite an amount of bone loss, and the gingival height opened up all those gaps between the lower anterior teeth. So he decided to go for veneers.
Genau. Das Ganze haben wir dann umgesetzt in die Versorgung mit einem IMEX-Material, also sprich vollmonolithisch gefräst, mit minimalster Schneidenschichtung noch.
Okay. So the, those veneers were made with IMEX, monolithic and stained or reduced and layered?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is before and after?
Hier nochmal im kleinen Video der Weg. von Anfang bis Ende.
Yeah, so this is still a video of this case presentation from the very beginning to the final result. So you know the reason why the patient didn't show up at the dental office for 20 years? You said he had a root canal treatment without anesthesia?
Yeah. That's real.
Well, you shouldn't do that.
We don't know. So, thanks a lot. So now we are on the end of our presentation. We hope you enjoy it, and we hope you have some questions. Then we can ask your question.
So, there's one question, how the jaw motion analyzer entered the treatment process. I guess this is not entirely clear to me. Can you specify your question, Ivan, please?
Okay.
At what point during the treatment was the jaw motion analyzer used? Also, möchte wissen, Ivan möchte wissen, an was für einem Punkt ist denn, weil wir keine Aufnahmen gezeigt haben von dem Jaw Motion Analyzer im Kontext mit dem Patienten, wo ist das denn zum Tragen gekommen?
Gleich am Anfang, nach dem Situationsscan, habe ich auch aufgrund des Situationsscan das Messbesteck hergestellt und dieses dann natürlich damit die Vermessung gemacht und dann die Relation der Kiefer zueinander gezeigt.
Das heißt, könnten wir vielleicht noch mal kurz zu dem Bild 21 zurückgehen?
Klar.
Ja. Yes, definitely before the temps, actually that was probably not clearly communicated. Thanks for bringing it up again, Ivan. The very first step was to take those intraoral scans, and after or simultaneously, you can say at the same day, beside the intraoral scans, the jaw motion recording was also performed. So it was the start of the whole treatment at the very beginning. Yeah. And I see David, was the anterior splint made from the original digital scans of the patient the same way we construct the biothosis? Well, you know what, David, there is a slight deviation here in our specific workflow here. Since this patient had such an enormous amount of wear and teeth which were very sensitive and required actually immediate action, they didn't go through the procedure of designing an appliance in the first place like we actually talked about before. They used this anterior jig and the recording with the jaw motion analyzer to directly start the workflow to fabricate those eggshell TEMs. The temporary restoration that was later on, which were later on fabricated and then stayed in the mouth for 3.5 months, were a substitute, if you will, so a slight deviation. And to answer the question regarding scanners, every intraoral scanner, I would say you should look for the latest versions of intraoral scanners just to make sure that they're really fully equipped to do full arch scans, can be used to be imported into the jaw motion analyzer software.
Beim Zerek ist nur noch dazu zu sagen, dass der Scanner es natürlich kann, aber wenn man echte dynamische Bewegung will, kann es zurzeit nur die Exocut, das Real Movement, wirklich umsetzen.
So, let me, there are a couple of questions and we will answer them in a chronological order. So there's one question, how does it work for Zerek? I'm not quite sure what that means. Are you referring, when you refer to Zerek, to the designing software? Are you referring to the intraoral scanner? And if so, then is it a blue cam, an omnicam, or what version would it be? So that would be important, we will wait for that specification. And to you, David, could we make the workflow as we have in the past? I would definitely say yes. Then we have Simon. Do you need to import the intraoral scans into the zebris software before you start the recording of the jaw movements?
No.
This is, if you will, an additional option, right?
Genau.
If you like to, maybe we can show this in one of the images. The software operates with a skull where the mandible is separated, and it animates this skull, which is just a reference. But if you like to work with your and be able to visualize actually your individual jaw motion recording, then you would import the intraoral scans into the software. So that's just an additional benefit. It's not a must. It's not that you have to have an intraoral scan in order to make use of the jaw motion analyzer. Yeah. Not at all.
Eher andersrum. Yeah. Also er braucht nachher eher, weil den Relationsscan der beiden Scans macht er dann natürlich mit dem Registrat.
Oh.
Also er macht ja den klassischen UK, also Lower Jaw, Upper Jaw, den Markerscan mit Registrat. Mhm. Also es ist eher, man kann es einlesen, wir können es in der Software ja mal zeigen.
Ja.
Hier sieht man es jetzt mit der...
Ja, so here you see two, well, a maxillary and a mandibular scan, and they are being merged with all the information that has been recorded, so the bite fork, the panted bite fork, and so if you perform this kind of scan procedure, then it allows you, the software allows you to watch the real movement of a specific patient. Otherwise, it is just using this reference skull and mandible to display the movement of the condyles and the incisal point of the lower arch in 3D space. How can I match my lower jaw scan with the measured movement? How do you do that? Also wie
den Unterkiefer einmatchen. Na gut, die Bewegung wird immer aus der habituellen eingematcht. Also darüber, weil das System es ja einmisst, ist der Unterkiefer natürlich automatisch aus der habituellen Position wird die Bewegung aufgezeichnet. Und das übernimmt er natürlich eins zu eins.
Ja, ich glaube, also die Frage geht über den Kopplungslöffel. Also der Kopplungslöffel dient ja dazu, den Oberkiefer
zu positionieren. Und der Unterkiefer wird ja immer aus der gleichen Startposition übernommen und das ist in dem Fall die Schlussbissposition.
Nur wie woher weiß die Software, wie der Intraoralscan vom Unterkiefer im 3D-Raum positioniert werden muss?
Wie weiß er das jetzt, wenn ich vorfragt?
Das über das Attachment.
Ja, klar, genau, weil das Attachment ist ja definiert, die Größe des Attachments.
Vielleicht könnt ihr das gerade nochmal zeigen?
Genau.
Okay. So when you perform the recording, keep in mind that you're using this attachment, and so this attachment actually captures the exact position and reports that to the system. So these two, so now you measure the software realizes the distance between the attachment and your measuring field, and so in 3D space, that's how the mandibular scan is then being placed in the right position in the software.
Yeah. Also die Größe ist definiert und darüber ist sie.
Yeah. Do I have to scan the attachment fixed on the jaw? No, you don't scan the attachment. You don't have to.
Yeah.
Can my trios scan be stitched to zebris? Must I purchase exocad software? Well, I guess that's depending on what you're planning to do. The exocad software is designing software, David, and therefore Well, if you want to start your own designing software, process, definitely you would have to purchase the exocad software. The exocad software again uses this common scan file format STL. In other words, your TRIO scanner in your case allows you to export your intraoral scans in the STL format, and therefore you could import it into the exocad software. Do I have to scan the attachment fixed on the jaw while scanning? No. I guess what is hard to understand is how is the mandibular jaw merged with the recording data, so that it is actually directly at the position where it's supposed to be.
Können Sie mir übersetzen nochmal?
Also, was den Leuten unklar ist, ist, wir haben jetzt hier also einen intraoral Scan, aber wie geht also vom Unterkiefer, wie bringe ich also praktisch diesen und wie wird dieser Unterkiefer in die exakt richtige Position gebracht?
Über den Scan. Also wir scannen ja den Unterkiefer im Grunde genommen zu. Über die Zustellung des Scans ist es ja von der Relation, wir haben ja einmal den Unterkiefer-Scan, einmal den Oberkiefer-Scan in der Relation zueinander. Mhm. Der Oberkiefer wird ja über den Kopplungskabel positioniert und der Unterkiefer wird über den Scanner hinzugegeben. Und da die Geometrie der Bisskabel im Grunde genommen eingelegt oder hinterlegt ist in der Software, weiß er genau, wo steht dort hinter der Unterkiefer. Und kann dann die dynamische Bewegung dazu aufzeichnen.
Okay. Yeah. Well, let's go to the very start. If you perform an intraoral scan, you scan the maxillary arch, you scan the mandibular arch. And then after you captured all these informations, you perform a so-called buccation. In other words, your scanning software captures the position of the mandible in relation to the maxillary scan. So later, when you perform the jaw motion recording, this attachment this bite fork actually communicate to the software via this metal plate here, first of all, in which distance the maxillary scan is related to your hinge axis or to your condyles. And the same thing goes for this attachment, same metal plate again, and this distance is known, so the distance between this plate and the very tip where this attachment reaches the incisal point of the two lower centrals. So this position is known, this distance, sorry, is known to the software. And so with this bite fork, you simply tell the software, this is the very position in relationship to the condyles where my maxillary scan is. And now the software has the information from your intraoral scan where the mandible is in relationship to the maxillary scan, and that's all you need.
in the software.
Excuse me, can my panadent be inserted? valid point. Right now, the panadent articulator is not part of the zebris software. All I know is that it is already in the exocad software, and zebris medical systems and panadent are currently, if I'm not mistaken, in communication, so that your desire could be fulfilled, David. But there is a gap between the attachment and the teeth. How can the software know the position? Again, the maxillary scan You take an intraoral scan. Let's go back one more time. I tried to go back to zero. So you have the intraoral scan. You capture the maxillary arch and you capture the mandibular arch. And then you do your buccal bite width restoration. So you have two jaws in a specific relationship to each other. That's all you need at that point. So now you take this bite fork, and this bite fork has impressions of the maxillary maxillary arch, and there are three referent points. Maybe we can bring up this procedure one more time. Hopefully it will be better understandable for you guys. Hold on just a second, and then yeah, there we go. So we have this bite fork, and this bite fork has those. Do we have a laser pointer actually?
No, it's a seat but
okay, well, you don't see it. but isn't there in this video this procedure?
Mouse.
Okay, so you have those markers, and those markers are known in the zebris software, and they're also known. In the position is known in the zebris software, and is also known in the exocad software. So now you know the position of the maxillary scan, and that's all it takes, because you have the relation between the maxillary scan to the mandibular scan captured with your buccal bite registration during your scanning procedure. That's it.
Und zebris gibt dann im Grunde den Movement Marker aus, dass wir wissen, wie wird die Bewegung ausgeführt. Genau.
So there's another question in your presentation. You were matching the upper cheek and exocad, and at the same time need to have scan of your upper file with that's correct. Yes. So if you use a jig, you want to use that jig also for your buccal bite registration. That's correct. Who does the contact regarding the zebris equipment? David, I would like to ask you to reach out through the zebris website and get in touch with them, and they will tell you which dealer to contact.
So I think we are finished. No questions more. Ah,
nice presentation.
Thanks
David.
A lot.
Okay, full of questions, but I will address them personally. Sure. And thanks for attending at the webinar.
Thanks a lot.
Enjoy your weekend. Have a great Friday. And see you soon again.
Thanks a lot. Goodbye.